I'm going to play two songs that I picked at random, and I want you to see what. Okay, let's give up on that. So, what I was attempting to show you there was this song, Hallowed Be Thy Name, and a random music video. So what happened, you can try it at home. What happened when I played those two was that you couldn't tell it was two different songs. Like, if you didn't know what you're seeing, you would think it was the same song. The beats are almost the same, and your mind fills in the gaps. You think that the song corresponds to the video. So this is what we call confirmation bias. So what happens is, when you see some data, you get an idea in your head, and you believe that this idea corresponds to that data, and so you fill in the blanks, and this way you try to make sense out of that data. So I would like somebody from the audience to try to attempt to guess the next number in this puzzle. So what we're going to do is, you're going to tell me what number I should fill into that. Into the blank, and if it's the right number, I'll say yes. If it's the wrong, I'll say no. And then after a few iterations, you shall tell me what this series is all about. So go for it. So I want an audience, ma'am. So right now I'm going to write down the answer in this piece of paper, so you know I'm not cheating. Right, I've got it on screen anyway. So what you're going to do is tell me a number that fills in the blank. Okay, yes. So this is what you're going to do. You're going to fill in subsequent blanks as we go on. And once you're sure what the series is about, then I shall reveal the answer. And let's see how close you got. So you say the answer is 100. So we'll write down 100. For that, I say yes, correct. Next. 169. Okay. Another yes. So you might want to make it, be sure of what the series is going to be, and then you can give me your guess as to what the series is about. Okay, that's one guess, and the answer is wrong. So we have a series. That's 1, 16, 49, 100, 169. What you've got to do is tell me what would the next number, or what the next number would be to complete the series. Once you're sure of what the series is, you tell me the series and I'll tell you whether it's right or wrong. I shall fill that in, that's correct. Go on.
16, 49, 72.
Okay. Obvious. You've given me another sequence, is it?
See, if you're saying this is wrong.
Yeah. No, the individual numbers are correct. Every individual number you've said is correct on the series. So, yeah, let's start again. So, continue the series. No, that's okay.
So if we see the last two numbers, there is 16 and 49.
Right.
The difference between the digits is 5, and the digits are increasing at 1 plus 3 is 4, and 9 plus 6, 6 plus 3 is 9.
Okay, so give me a next number in the series.
It could be, if 4 becomes 7, the difference 5 is only possible with 2, so 72.
So you say 72 would be a number that completes it? That's right. So tell me the series.
Stop after some time.
Let me give you one clue. This is an infinite series. So what we're doing here, for those who walked in late, so I have a series here. 1, 4, 49, 72 is the answer this gentleman provided. So what you're going to do is tell me one number that should complete the series. And once you're sure of what the series is, tell me what's the rule that comes behind the series. If you get it right, great, you get one internet.
100.
Cool, 100 is right. What's the series?
It is, they're getting up by 3 each, and it's a square of that. 1 to 4 square to 7 square, 7 to 10 square.
100 is a correct answer, but the underlying rule is wrong. So, yeah, enough of that. I'll tell you what the underlying rule is. Don't throw things at me. This is the underlying rule. So what happened here is that you made up a rule in your head, and you fit in data that would validate your hypothesis, and so you gave that answer. Whatever answer you gave was correct. So the only way to try to actually get the underlying rule in this was to give a smaller number, which we don't think. This is, you know, the only people who actually get this kind of question right are chess grandmasters and very good investors, because they're used to knowing that the only way you're sure your idea is right is by invalidating it. Validation proves nothing. So yeah, this is actually something I told a friend of mine who was convinced that her abusive boyfriend had changed. However much you try to prove your hypothesis, you might get it right. You might be able to prove your hypothesis over and over again and still be stuck with the wrong answer. This could go on forever. You can give 100, 169, 256, so on and so forth for 10 days until you're sure your hypothesis is correct and you say it's n plus 3 square. But it's wrong. The answer is the simplest thing in the dictionary. It's ascending order. That's it. So the whole idea behind this is called the confirmation bias. So once you're so sure, once you fit an idea in your head onto the world, it's very difficult to get off that. And the only way to correct yourself is getting off that idea, trying to disprove yourself. Once you disprove yourself, if you said 15 now and I said wrong, then that's an invaluable clue. But saying 14, what, 50? 50 will also give you a clue saying that it's not n plus 1 square. So basically, if you have an idea in your head, try to disprove it. This way you'll be closer to getting to your answer more quickly. So let's move on. Let's see, I don't need to. This slide. So yeah, this is something I pointed out during my intro speech. Could you just pass this around? Does everybody have a pen? Everyone's got a pen, right? At least every two neighbor, if you have a pen, that's good. So just pass this around. If there's more paper required, I'll tear some more for you. So this kind of confirmation bias has been seen in daily life. It goes by many names. One is called the blue car syndrome. For example, just a few days ago, I bought a blue car. And suddenly when I go on the streets, I see blue cars everywhere. It was random noise before. I wouldn't have noticed the blue cars in the street. But now that I have one, I've inserted a data point into my head. So now I see this data everywhere. I remark about how blue must be a very common color. Everybody seems to be buying blue. So, and this goes, I shall outline a scam for you. This was the scam was used multiple times throughout history. I'm sure it will be used many times more. And so I would like you to try to figure it out. If you already know the answer, keep it for some time so that somebody's got a chance of working it out. This was the World Cup that happened last year, a couple years ago, which you won. Assume on the first day, on 23rd March, West Indies-Pakistan encounter, you get an email halfway through the match, or just before the match starts, saying that Pakistan is going to win today. It's a spam email. Millions of those come to your box every day. The email saying Pakistan is going to win. You ignore it, like you should ignore spam. And a few hours later, you see that Pakistan indeed won. That's pretty cool. So the next day, you get another email, for the Australia-India encounter saying India is going to win. Now you're slightly piqued, your interest is slightly piqued, and you want it to win because you want India to win. And sure enough, India wins, right? And then the third day, now you're slightly interested, you're looking forward to that spam email that's coming. So it says New Zealand versus South Africa, New Zealand's going to win. Now you're interested, could this be true? And so what do you know? New Zealand does win. And let me assure you, there's no match fixing happening here. And the next day you have an England versus Sri Lanka, you see Sri Lanka has won. The email comes saying Sri Lanka is going to win, and it's won. Now this is where things get a little more heated up, it's the semi-finals. Next day you get an email saying that if you want to know the result of today's match, send in $10. So you're thinking, could it be worth it? It also comes with a link to a gambling site where you can put in as much money as you want to get your money back. $10 isn't too much money, So I send down that fellow my my credit card, okay, not credit card, I send him down 500 rupees. And I get an answer saying, India is going to win, yes, India is going to win. So I don't want to invest too much yet. So I get an email saying, India is going to win. I keep my interest up. And what do you know, India's won. Now you're assured that this is Polly the Octopus who's sending you emails. You're sure that this guy's got something going on, he knows how to predict the future. Again, an email comes saying, New Zealand, Sri Lanka is going to win. Now you're sure, you're looking forward with abated interest at the match because you've bet a few dozen dollars on it. And sure you have it, Sri Lanka has won. Now for the final, he reveals his big coup de grace, right? He tells you, for the result of today's match, send down $1,000. And he gives you a high stakes betting site where you can bet your lifetime's money and make a big deal. And so you go ahead, bet, you go ahead, pay him your money, and you lose, right? You lose. You've lost all your money now. Now you think back onto how this might have worked. Let me assure you again, this is not match fixing. This is not some ICC spokesperson who's sending out the email. This is just another guy. Could you figure out how this scam might have developed right from start? A gentleman that has answered?
He might have sent mail to millions of people and by probably.
Exactly. So initially, I have a sample space of 1 million. I've got your email addresses of 1 million people. I send out emails to everybody saying, half of them, 500,000 saying West Indies will win, half of them saying Pakistan will win. One iteration later, right, I know that half of the audience can be convinced further. I can have them give me money. I send only that 500,000 whom I sent that Pakistan would win, another email. Now 250,000 of them, I tell them India will win, 250,000 Australia. So we're going on, 8 iterations later, I have around, 1 million over 2 power, 6, 2, 1 million over 64. Around a few thousand people who are convinced that I am that octopus sitting in France, who are convinced that whatever I say is gold, and I can get them to invest a lot of money. All by doing is that a large sample space to begin with, keep edging down smaller and smaller until these, the players whom I'm targeting are the ones who have never seen the dark side of me, never seen me lose. So these guys are sure to pay me. So that is a very common scam. And since this looks very far away, let's bring it back to something closer, something that many of us might have seen. Assume, work backwards on the same thing. Start a company, employ 1,000 traders, right? And assume this is it's a zero-sum game. It normally isn't, but it's pretty close. Assume that in this game of investing, stock marketing, for a stock sales buying, assume that at the end of year, half your people are going to lose money, half your people are going to gain money, right? So at the end of year, fire the people who lost money. So fire 500 traders, put them out on the streets, and tell the 500 people who are still in the company that you are winners, right? This goes on for a few years. At the end of 7 years, you have 8 superstars who've never lost money in their whole lives. They're convinced that they are gods. They drive Ferraris, date Heidi Klums. And these, there are people like this. We call them the masters of the universe. They tend to reside in this place called Wall Street. Right? They have never lost a bet in their lives, and they're convinced that whatever they touch is pure gold. So you go on, biographers study their lives. They tell them, this guy went to this prep school when he was in 7th standard, where he met a student who changed his outlook on life and made him a winner. This goes on, biographers study their lives, tell them how great they are, and they're also convinced that they're gods, they're geniuses. Any stock they touch is going to turn to gold. So now I ask you, so far, each year, 50% of the people have been weeded out as losers. If you bet on these guys, how many of them are going to report a profit the next year? Are they all going to report a profit seeing as they're geniuses?
50-50.
Exactly 50%. So if you bet on them, you're still going to lose half your money. So even though they've never lost a bet in their lives, that doesn't mean that currently they might not lose. Yes, you're going to say something about how they might be scared.
They just close their eyes and say, okay, buy. Okay, sell. Head, sell. Tail, I buy. But they don't do that.
Exactly. So, but you're thinking of it from a personal perspective of one guy. So assume that, we are assume under the assumption that what he's doing is right, right? But look at it backwards. Imagine that it's being weeded down from thousands of people. This is
not completely applicable because there are elements of skill involved. But imagine that the world worked like this. Everybody in the starting has a coin and they toss it. If it lands heads, they get to go to the next stage. Lands tails, they don't. Right? So some 7 iterations down the line, there'll be people who've been scoring heads all their lives, and they assume that the coin, when they toss it, is going to land heads. Which is a simplification of it doing what we're doing in stock markets, because there are analysis, there are heuristics, but there are also surprises. So we cannot model the future exactly on how the past was modeled, which is, it led to huge stock collapses, like just a few years ago. In 2007, the market crashed around 80% of its value was lost within a few minutes. Because algorithms tend to model the past on the future, and they call it a correction and so on and so forth. But
how
the thing is...
How many people made money? It's just a handful of guys.
Yeah, a handful of guys made a lot of money.
Not 50%.
Yeah, that's right. See, basically, I modeled this on the coin flip. So
that collapse,
exactly. Okay. So now you give rise to an interesting point. Assume that most people are idiots. Okay, most people are idiots. Assume that you have a market, you have 1,000 stock traders, of which 80% of them are guaranteed to lose money, and 20% of them probably make money. Again, it's like a weighted coin. If you think about it, it's a weighted coin. If you are assured that at the end of the year 80% lose money, 20% will gain money. It's a weighted coin. That doesn't mean that the next year those 20 are still going to keep making money. They'll still be the same thing. 80% will make, 20% lose. So now we're going to come to that one or two superstars. We're going to converge on that really quickly. Somebody who's never lost money in their lives. And so they'll perhaps believe that it's something inherent to them. They might they might let go of their skill. They might believe that they're doing right. So again, in this case, you're still going to lose your money. So that leads to, it's called the survivorship bias. We tend to take evidence of people who survive. We tend to, at the end of the stage, we look at human beings as a survived evolution. So far, they must be really good. There must be something in their species that makes them superior to some species that wiped out. Is that the case? It could just be luck, right? We didn't get hit by the asteroids that destroyed all the dinosaurs just in that time. So, except that there are traits that make us more successful evolutionarily than some other. Except that we might be able to, keep ourselves alive a lot longer enough to go on procreate. But when it boils down to this, you're looking at winners and back calculating whether they're good or not. Look at this. Think about this. Every single person in this room has been through a lottery when we were born. Right, we won odds of about a few billion to one against when our particular sperm had fertilized a particular egg. And so everybody in this room is a winner of a huge lottery. A huge lottery, but a means of which you'll never win again. Trillion to one odds, we won't see again. We've already won that lottery. Does that mean we're that good at winning lotteries? Not really, right? It's a conditional probability of a past, and the past and probability doesn't really have a memory in most cases. So right now, if you have a toss-up between all of you guys, one person will win, even though every single person over here has won a huge lottery in the past. I don't mean they'll do it again. So history is written by the winners. We don't see huge artifacts of Carthage, but how they survived great apocalypses, because they lost one. Carthage was overrun by Hammurabi, and then we don't know anything about Carthage. Similarly, there are gods, great gods of other civilizations, of Tenochtitlana, there's a serpent-headed Quetzalcoatl god, who was the equivalent of the creator of their civilization. We don't hear about them because they lost. And winning or losing need not have something to do with inherent ability. It might just be that we are used to seeing winners, so we believe that they did something right to have come this far. Again, like I said, this has close ties with evolutionary selection. So again, we're sampling only winners, so we forget that there might be some things, some further cause above that might be causing these to win, which might not be inherent. Could this be luck? Could this be anything else? I don't know. Let's find out. So going back from the stockbroker example, about how after the one more year, again 50% of them would have lost, right? 50% would have lost money, 50% would have won. What would those same people, the same biographers who studied them so far, would they say? Would they say that they lost because they drank too much booze, drove too many fast cars? So this is called the narrative fallacy. It is the vulnerability to overinterpret facts and preference for compact sound bites, because you don't want to look at data and say, look, there's data. You want to make sense out of it, even if you have to force sense into it. I'll give you an example that happened a few years ago when Saddam Hussein was caught and executed. The morning he was executed, Wall Street fell by a few dozen points. And so Bloomberg is this popular financial tool. They reported the stock market fell by a few, so many points, because of Saddam Hussein's execution, and about how foreign investors are afraid to invest, investors are afraid to invest in foreign countries. Just a few hours later, the stock market went up again. And Bloomberg explained it as the exact same cause. Saddam Hussein was executed, so the score has gone. So when we try to interpret every little noise in life and try to put a cause to it, we can fool ourselves. You might be right sometimes, and most of the time that rightness or wrongness might not even matter. But we seem to put meaning to random data, in which we are basically wasting energy, spending our time instead of just looking at the facts and thinking what might be ahead. We spend too much time pushing back. How many times have you heard in college, like I'm assuming lots of people over here are from one of those top-notch colleges, when you go there, your parents will tell you, how come you're not scoring as well now as you did before? You were a topper before. The answer to that is everybody over there was a topper before. So now it's a new game altogether. You're playing with different set of variables, and the past doesn't really have too much of a significance now, because you know it's like a dice. If I throw a dice and it lands 5 times in a row, 1, that doesn't mean that the probability, of course, it's not a jugaad dice, it's a real dice. If it lands 1 5 times in a row, what is the probability of it landing 1 the 6th time? It's still, as always, 1/6, assuming that the dice is valid, which I am assuring you it is. So again, that's another interesting thing called the gambler's fallacy.
Is there something called random data as such, or is it only an inability to get some factors
into it? It's a very difficult question about how to classify something as truly random. So basically from math, We use things called linear congruent methods to get random numbers. We choose very large prime numbers and so on and so forth. But the thing is, even that is not truly random. It's called pseudo-random numbers. So what people do for generating random numbers, there's a website called randomnumber.org. So what they do is they map atmospheric data, atmospheric noise, and generate data from it, which at least in our systems we can consider that random. If there's a higher system which is controlling how the air behaves in our atmosphere, I don't know. And seriously, I don't care, because it's beyond me to comprehend such a system. I won't try to make an attempt at it. So that is how we must assume that something is random. Good, you had a question?
No, there is this website about empirical bias. So they have this nice article, how does randomness look like?
Right.
So yeah, I mean, you could. You could refer to that. So yeah, because exactly. I was in my job, somebody suddenly asked some patterns they had, and they wanted to tell the client that this is all, you know, you are trying to do this, and this is not random.
Okay, it's very difficult. It's
so
difficult,
yeah. So we plotted it into a Poisson distribution, and it was more or less, it ran some chi square test and looked more or less random.
Yeah, but the thing is, with all these tests, they are still. Okay, it's difficult to truly judge whether a number is random, because it's under the basis of pseudo-random generators or something. So unless you use actual verified random data like noise or let's say the sound in some certain room or whatever, it's very difficult to come to randomness. But then, it's a sidetrack. We shall get back to that now. My talk isn't about generating randomness. My talk is about analyzing randomness and seeing and its immediate application to daily life and how we fall. Like I was saying, the gambler's fallacy. So there is a very famous fallacy among most gamblers who believe that they toss a coin, it's come heads 3 times in a row, they'll think, okay, it can't come heads this time, because it's come head 3 times in a row, and they bet a lot of money on tails. And they might end up winning or losing. But the thing is, they are deluding themselves into thinking that the coin has memory, which it doesn't. The coin is going to land heads or tails based on 1,000 different things, but not whether it's landed that way in the past. So when we have narrative fallacy, we tend to take random data, we tend to take data and try to put a story behind it. which is great. We can't have a storybook which has lots of data. Nobody would read it. It would be boring. So when we put data into it, when we put extra data into it, that actually takes away something else. So check this out. Think about this. The king fell in war and the queen died. That's one statement. And the second statement is, the king fell in war and the queen died of grief. First one is pure data. King has died, queen has died. Second one adds two words to it, but essentially takes away so much from it. So we're saying, so in the second one, we're going to assume that the queen was so enamored by her king that she couldn't stand to live a moment when her king is dead, and so on and so forth. Whereas in the first one, there's actually a lot more data in this, even though it looks, you know, less catching. It's harder to remember the first sentence than the second. So let me quiz you on one small thing. Now we have two statements here. You have to tell me which is more likely. Raji is happily married. She killed her husband when she caught him cheating. Raji is happily married. She killed her husband. Which is more probable of these two sentences? The first one is what most people say. But if you think about it, the second one includes all cases where she's killed him and she's caught him cheating.
Second one, she could be a psychotic maniac.
Exactly. She could be a maniac. She killed him for no good reason. She might be happily married and her husband has lost all their money gambling on coins, flipping heads and tails. And so she killed him.
Killed him by accident.
She was cooking his favorite meal and, you know, by mistake she popped in the condiment that said cyanide. So he died. I don't know. There could be a thousand different reasons for this, and yet only one reason for this. And yet people believe that the first one is more likely because they draw a stop over here. She killed her husband, draw a stop over here. They consider this as two different events. And killing her husband, this suddenly looks very likely because if a wife catches her husband cheating, it's very likely that she's going to kill him, right? But we forget to add that this whole thing is only one sentence. We can't drop conditional probabilities when we feel like. We're not going to be told that Raji was happily married, she caught her husband cheating, and then she killed him. And she caught her husband cheating, then you'll be right. First one might be more probable. This, by the way, is used by insurance, a lot of fool people. So they have two brackets, one of them saying shop insurance. Your shop is insured until stolen. The second one, which was common in New York and Bombay after tragic events, they say, insurance against terrorism, which is marked up, which costs 6,000 rupees an annum versus 5,000 rupees an annum for insurance. A lot of shopkeepers bought this insurance which says it protects you against terrorists, which is just one of the many ways your shop can get raised. It can get raised by a meteor strike, it can get raised by the random mobs going crazy because somebody liked on Facebook. There'll be lots of things that can happen. And just one of those things is terrorism. And we're paying a 1,000 rupee premium there, extra, because we do not know how to interpret probabilities. This is inside the human condition. It is not something external. Because we've been told that something that looks more likely is more likely. Whereas what you're supposed to do is, you know, think about it from an external perspective, calculate probabilities independent of your own biases. And this is really hard. So one more thing, which is very common, a lot of you might have seen it. If a family member gets caught in an accident, you are more likely to start wearing a helmet for the wrong reasons. The probability of you having an accident hasn't really changed unless you are severely affected by it. The chances that traffic conditions are going to get worse because that guy has had an accident isn't going to change. But you start wearing a helmet anyway. If you start wearing a helmet because you suddenly understood that it's the right thing to do, it's one thing. But chances are you're going to wear it because somebody has told you, this guy had an accident, wear a helmet. It's very likely.
It's playing on psychology,
but then we tend to misrepresent the calculations in our head. We tend to believe that the cause of accident in my family might rise because that guy got hurt,
chance of me getting hurt is more, which is not true. It's the same as ever. You were an idiot before for not wearing an helmet. You're no longer an idiot now. That's it. That's the only thing that's changed. The probability of having an accident has remained the same. So, and think about lotteries. It's again, if I make a lottery here, if I say that all you people here write down something, one of you is going to win. The probability of this is only what, 1 in 30 or 40 or so. But every one of you will over-represent the probability of winning your head. Everyone's looking forward to win. And if you think about it, you're in your head, the probability of winning will be greater than the actual thing it is. Now, if you expand that to a larger perspective, right? If there's 1 million people playing, or 100,000 people playing, do you actually register any difference in your head if there's 100,000 and a million? Do you change the chances of your winning in your head? It's just a big number, you don't know. So the higher numbers get, we lose out. We forget as to how large numbers can be used to confuse you and make you misrepresent the probability in your head. Okay, I've passed out those papers, right? I hope everyone's got a pen. This is not a lottery, this is a small experiment I want to conduct. Does everybody have a piece of paper and a pen? Yeah. I'm sorry, you should have. So if everyone's got a paper and a pen, if you don't have pens, I'll pass them around. Please send them back because they're useful for somebody's next talk. Please return these. They'll be here for the next talk. So,
calculated the pens coming back to you as well?
I'm assuming it's one, else nobody leaves. So what I want you to do now, it's not related to what's been happening so far. I want you to write down the last 5 digits of your phone number. I'm not going to spam because only the last 5 digits. Write down the last 5 digits of your phone number and then estimate the number of buses in Bangalore. Write down the last 5 digits of your phone number first. Down the last 5 digits of your phone number and then think about how many buses might be plying on the roads of Bangalore.
Just
imagine the number. No, there's no correct answer, wrong answer here. I'm not going to give a prize to the one who got it, right? Because I have no idea. No, the only thing you have to do is write down the last 5 digits of your phone number. And then write how many buses you think are there in Bangalore. Okay, if you're done, just pass the papers on forward so we can just have a look at all of them. Okay. Thank you. Called beginner's luck. Lots of gamblers say this. I used to win, man, and then my luck ran out. Consider a case where you start gambling. You go to a casino one day and gamble, and you lose. You lose money. You'll go home dejected and decide never to gamble again. There'll be another guy who, on his first day, made a lot of money. He'll think he's a blessed one. He has been chosen by the gods of gambling. And so he goes back to gambling every single day of his life. And one day he'll tell you, my luck ran out. So this is commonly called beginner's luck because, again, silent evidence. The ones who lost on their first day probably didn't go back at all. So we have a sample which is skewed onto people who won on their first day and believe that they have beginner's luck.
Something like cricket.
Possibly. But yeah, just because it happened at some point in their life doesn't mean it's going to happen forever. So when I'll end my speech through this, it's been told a million times by people across, you know, faiths and beliefs and all about how the earth is perfect. The earth is so great that if the G constant had been slightly less, our bodies couldn't have evolved like they are. If the percentage of oxygen in the atmosphere was slightly low,
we couldn't have evolved, we couldn't have been born. Such perfection cannot be brought by chance, right? It's impossible that this earth was, you know, came about by random chance, people tossing dice. Is it impossible that the earth could have been formed by just chance? So this is what we're talking about. We're looking at something that one, assume that evolving life on a certain planet one. Assume that the planet thinks it's one. So this kind of case, we believe that the earth was created for us because everything seems to be perfect, while the actual answer is we evolved here because it just happened. There is no cause attached to it. Our presence in the sample negates all the possible, you know, probabilities that led to it. Just like every single of you was born because you won a one in a trillion lottery, does not mean that, okay, everyone's special, but that isn't. So everyone's special. So our planet has won a great lottery, and there is evidence to prove that there are lots of other planets, there are millions of other planets. You've not found life in them. What if every one of them wasn't part of the same dice roll, but we somehow won? Does that mean we're special? Just means that we were in that sample, and it won. Does not mean the Earth was created for our express benefit. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I'll collect this data and see if there's any findings from it. If there is, I shall send it to you. This way I can prove that, you know, that thing is true. Because again, only the silent evidence. If it's false, I won't send you any news.
You were talking about how a lot of stock trading, heuristic
money, then it would be a very strange universe in which everybody has the same amount of money.
So actually you are saying the way stock markets or the algorithms they work on is by heuristically taking up the previous data. So you are actually falsifying that hypothesis, but are you providing anything as an alternative?
See, there is alternatives. One is you place the right bets. And it's called, in gambling also, they call this bankroll management. And don't put all your eggs in one basket. The only way you can, you know, take benefits of the fact that low probability events are likely to happen, it's a huge payoff, is by putting small amounts of your bets in place with high payoff. So turn up to conferences like this where you can meet a lot of people who are doing cool stuff. Even though I'm spending, what, half a day here. And the chances are, in case I meet somebody who provides a business opportunity and it rises, so I'm investing, what, 1 by 365 by 2 of my time into this. And the chances are, there is a small chance that this bet might lead to $1 million business. So the only thing we can do, because we cannot hide from probability, it's going to kick you one day or the other, is lay your bets out, have put 80% of your money in boring FDs, which are guaranteed to pull out 10% each year, and invest small amounts in huge things, which have chances, small chance of paying off really big. It's the only thing you can do.
Managing your portfolio is the only way large companies can and do survive.
You need to make big bets, but not with all your money. That's setting up yourself for defeat. Okay, Ninad's throwing me out of the room right now. We'll all be going for lunch. After the lunch, come down to one session of graphology. It's handwriting analysis. So it's pretty interesting. Come down for it.
Which is why we
and return your pencils! Return your pencils!